because our mothers love us. They rather frequently warn us. It starts with words often spoken to the very young. Hot, don't touch. Chew your food before you swallow it. Go to sleep. Be careful on the steps. Look both ways before you cross the street. Be gentle. Don't hit or hurt. Be polite. Always say thank you. Mothers give these warnings not to hurt us, but to help us, because they want to protect us from harm. And as we grow older, these admonitions will often come with predictions of what will happen if we keep doing what is wrong and not doing what is right. A loving mother might say, if you don't get a good education, you'll be poor all your life. Watch who you pick for your friends. If you hang around with hoodlums, you could end up being a hoodlum. If you try drugs, you could get hooked on drugs. If you do not respect your own body and your human sexuality, certainly no one else will. Pray. Go to Mass. Always try to do what is right. In the tradition of the Catholic Church, Mary, the mother of Jesus, has always been invoked as our blessed mother. And as we heard in the words of today's Holy Gospel, it was from the cross that Jesus gave her to us as our mother. Remember that Mary remained with the apostles, gathered in prayer on Pentecost Sunday in Jerusalem, where the Holy Spirit descended in tongues of fire, and the church, which is the body of Christ, was brought to birth. This was certainly appropriate, since Mary was obviously there in Bethlehem, when Jesus was born in the flesh. She was the first to welcome Jesus in her life. And so she is the first and greatest of all the disciples. Mary, after her death, was assumed into heaven as a sign of the church's future destiny. From the earliest days of Christianity, believers have always loved and remembered Mary, because Mary has always loved and remembered us. In the wondrous communion of saints, Mary prays with and for the church. And as a loving and attentive mother, in many places and in many eras, Mary has appeared to warn her children of present danger, to shelter them from future harm. As when she appeared to Juan Diego in Mexico at Tepeyac, the lady asked, "Am I not your mother?" As she appeared to Bernadette Soubirous at Lourdes in France and asked for prayer and penance and for conversion of all sinners. And as she appeared at the coma at Fatima, as a horrific world war raged on, and only decades before, an even worse world war would break out. And just before atheist and communism spread its oppressive and destructive evils across the world. In humanity's great need, the Blessed Mother appeared in Portugal to three heroic shepherd children, Lucia, their cousins Francisco and Jacinta. Our Lady again called for prayer and penance, but especially for continuing conversion, what Father Andrew Apostoli has described as Mary's peace plan. spiritual secrets were revealed to the children, and visions, both terrible and wonderful, were eventually made known to the whole world. As always, not everyone would accept the message, but in manifest vindication of Mary's promises, on October the 13th, in the month of the Holy Rosary, 100 years ago, at the Cova in Fatima, there occurred the miracle of the sun. It was witnessed by at least 70,000 people, a multitude of both believers and unbelievers, including reporters from anti-Catholic newspapers, indifferent soldiers, and anti-clerical government officials. There had been a heavy, drenching rain that had poured down all day. Mary was revealed to the visionaries as Our Lady of the Rosary. She said that war would soon end and that the soldiers would return home. She asked the people to stop offending God by their sins. Then she opened her beautiful hands, reflecting an incandescent heavenly light. Lucia stood up and cried out, "Look at the sun!" And as the crowd gazed up into dark skies, the sun suddenly appeared out of the gloom, and then actually seemed to dance, spinning and turning, and even changing colors. This phenomenon was seen from as far away as 25 miles. Amazement among the vast multitude quickly turned into sheer terror as a blazing bright sun amid swirling black clouds suddenly seemed to hurl itself towards the earth. People screamed in panic, fearing that this was the end of the world. Some ran, some tried to hide, others knelt in prayer, begging for God's mercy. And just as suddenly, the sun peacefully returned to its accustomed place in the heavens. The atmosphere cleared, and the ground instantly became dry. People rejoiced in astonishment. Miracles of healing were witnessed, and profound personal conversions changed many hearts and minds. The miracle of the sun should come as no surprise to anyone familiar with the 12th chapter of the book of Revelation. As we heard in today's second reading, a woman appears in the sky, clothed with the sun. Here Mary is envisioned as the faithful daughter of Israel, who in the fullness of time brought the Savior into this world. Here she is also presented as the type and the symbol of the church, the new Israel of God, relentlessly attacked by the ancient serpent, but conquering Satan by the blood of the Lamb and the word of testimony. The woman awaits the consummation of all things and the new heaven and the new earth. In the rich tradition of Catholic liturgy, there is an exalted prayer of thanksgiving dating from late antiquity that praises the discipleship of Mary by remembering the many faithful daughters of Israel who foreshadowed Our Lady. The text proclaims Mary in these words: "You are Sarah, who gave birth to Isaac, the child of the promise. You are Rachel, who gave birth to Joseph, whose discernment fed Israel with sustaining food. You are Deborah, who inspired Pilate, Naphtali, and Zebulun to defeat the enemies of their people. You are Manoah, who gave birth to Samson, the mighty judge who tore down the temple of the Philistines. You are Ruth, even more faithful to Naomi than seven sons. You are thankful Hannah, who gave birth to Samuel, the mighty prophet of God. You are Abishag, who gave warmth and comfort to royal David. You are prayerful Judith, who crushed the head of Halphernes and sang your hymn of thanksgiving. You are Esther, who by your courage saved the nation and destroyed Haman. You are true, most blessed among all women. Oh, most glorious Virgin Mary, who gave birth to our Savior and who won heaven for us. Entirely beautiful, singularly graced, elect and predestined among all our race, no taint of sin was ever found in you. Really, every prophecy that Mary fulfilled is a lesson for all of us, her children, in our journey of Christian faith. Mary always conforms, unites, and consecrates us to her Son, Jesus Christ. It may be that today we need the prophetic message of Fatima more than ever before. Just as in 1917, the world in 2017 is fractured by war and terror, enthralled and disfigured by grievous sin. There is widespread contempt for our sacred Catholic faith, and even disdain for the very notion of God. As St. Paul once wrote to the Ephesians, our war is not only against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and the forces of darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness. The devil never rests. As the scriptures warn, be vigilant, because your enemy the devil goes abroad like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Today, demonic forces are at work to deconstruct marriage, even to entirely redefine human gender in what some now have described as the new normal. The world seems to be living through a kind of moral meltdown, where drugs, crime, random violence, and a profoundly degraded understanding of human sexuality seem to dominate our culture. Perhaps our greatest temptation would be to simply give up our mission of Christian service and witness and hide and surrender to our fears. But remember that as St. John taught in his first letter, the spirit that is in you is greater than the spirit that is in the world. Christians belong to God, and through their baptism, they already share in a new life in Christ, and so have already really won the victory. The devil is always a liar who tries to deceive and intimidate God's people, whom he envies and hates. Our shield against the lies of Satan is the word of God that always tells the truth. Our invincible weapon is the precious atoning blood of Christ, poured out on the altar of the cross and truly made present in the holy sacrifice of the Mass. Our reassurance consistent intercession with the Fatima prayer. O Jesus, save us from our sins, deliver us from the fires of hell, and lead all souls to heaven, especially those in the most need of your mercy. And with confidence in God's mercy, recall and then live the words of Saint John Paul the Great. Do not be afraid. He was convinced that his own life was saved from assassination through the direct protection of Our Lady of Fatima. So as we celebrate the centennial of Our Lady's miracle of the Son, in every place that can be named, where martyrs conquer and the just shine forth, we rise up in prayerful exaltation and cry out together, Hail Mary, full of grace, most blessed among women, and most elect of all our race. On earth as in heaven, even in the midst of wondrous angelic worship, Mary, the Mother of God, is greater in splendor than the cherubim, higher in honor than the seraphim. Blessed Lady, your life of faith, the faithful will always try to imitate. Queen of the angels, Queen of all saints, O glorious ever Virgin Mary, today and always, we give heart-filled thanks to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for giving you to us